All right, so let's look at some Dynasty League guys that I picked some names at semi-random. And Fabs, you know, you can give me your impression. We'll talk about whether their stock is up or stock is down. Obviously, this is based on a Dynasty League perspective as opposed to just like a redraft or a keeper league sort of thing. So I figure we start at the quarterback position. Dak Prescott, who has been fantastic over the last few years, especially fantasy-wise. He's in a situation where I know the Cowboys are trying to get a deal done with him. That is sort of in limbo right now. So the future of Dak Prescott, whether it is in Dallas surrounded by all these weapons or whether it's somewhere else, is sort of, you know, it's kind of hanging in the balance. Are we feeling better about him, worse about him, about the same about Dak Prescott right now?
If anything, I think his value's increased a little bit because of the addition of CeeDee Lamb. And that offense is going to be among the top three or four in the league. At least it's projected to be. And, you know, Dak's still a young man. I mean, he's 26 years old. So he's probably, what, the QB three or four in redrafts. And he's certainly top five in Dynasty as well. So I feel like he's underrated. And I'm not saying that because I'm a Cowboys fan. But he finished as the QB two last year. Lamar Jackson was the only quarterback who scored more fantasy points than Dak Prescott. He's been pretty damn good for most of his career, and it's a short one. He did have that stretch without Zeke Elliott where he struggled, but Dak's been pretty damn good from a fantasy perspective. And now you add in CeeDee Lamb, and that offense is going to be clicking on all cylinders. He's young. I say his value has increased a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's fair. I mean, especially when you talk about what they have around him. I guess my only hesitation is just where he may be in the future. But I mean, I think wherever he goes, I think Dak has shown that he's good enough to kind of thrive and flourish in a lot of different situations. So I think maybe everything's okay. I think he definitely hasn't gotten worse. You know, I think at worst for him, his value kind of stays the same, but I think adding CeeDee Lamb sort of helps him a little bit.
Sure.
Gardner Minshew, he's the guy in Jacksonville. I mean, they sort of settled on that by not going out and adding anybody to really challenge him at the quarterback position. I mean, they
you just get hurt Mike Glennon's feelings, man.
I mean, look, I think we all know.
It's not Cam. They could have went after Cam and they didn't. So
right,
Cam's with the question marks about his health and the situation that we're in with the coronavirus, no one's taking a chance, and that's obvious now.
Yeah, I mean, so obviously they believe in Minshew, and that's cool. I still have questions about sort of what's around him. I mean, we saw some good things. We saw some flashes from some of his receivers. They still have Leonard Fournette for the time being. I guess I just worry about him because I don't trust the Jaguar front office to get this right, because when's the last time the Jaguar front office got this right?
Minshew's, I mean, in Dynasty, certainly, you know, he's got youth on his side. He showed flashes last season. He's got some good young weapons in the offense, but it's hard to, I mean, as you just mentioned, it's hard to trust Jacksonville. I mean, it just really is. So, you know, they've had some good draft picks. Jalen Ramsey now is with the Rams. You know, Fournette, I mean, I guess the jury is still out on whether or not he's actually worked out or not. Probably his last year in Jacksonville. You know, Minshew averaged right around 16 fantasy points per game last season. I mean, it's okay. I mean, it's not great by any stretch of the imagination. I don't feel like he's going to turn into, you know, the next Mark Brunell, because that's the standard
for Jaguars quarterback.
That's what I'm just thinking. So, but he is what he is. I mean, he's a QB2 in Dynasty, and maybe even a QB3 in Dynasty.
Yeah, I mean, there's just so many things that are possible for him, right? I mean, like the fact that he doesn't have any real competition, that they are, you know, handing the reins over to him. But then I guess at the same time, it also feels like if things go sideways this year, that it's not going to really cost them that much to move on and go find somebody else. So it is sort of a tenuous situation for Minshew. I think I wonder if he's sort of going to be the football equivalent of Jeremy Lin, right? Remember Jeremy Lin?
I remember Jeremy Lin. I had him on my fantasy basketball team.
Yeah, right. Like he, you know, he had that amazing run for a few weeks there with the Knicks, and you know, Lin's sanity kind of swept the nation. Everything was great. Like, I mean, do we have like men's sanity with Gardner Minshew last year, where he was like everybody's favorite for a while, and he was like the most popular Halloween costume in Duval County last year. And I just wonder
there was all kinds of Minshews running around during October.
Yeah, all the time. And I just wonder whether or not he can kind of sustain that, or if he goes back to sort of, you know, just kind of being a guy again. So, all right. So this is the big one. And we sort of talked about this a little bit on Tuesday's show. Christian McCaffrey. I mean, it's hard to think his stock can go up just because he was so great last year. Very nearly set a record for fantasy points in a season. He gets paid. But the downside, Fabs, is that the workload has been huge for him the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. He gets 1 year older, which, you know, for running backs is always seems to be a bad thing. I think he's still a guy that goes very early in startup redraft leagues or startup dynasty leagues. He's still going to be the number one overall pick, most likely. Redraft leagues, he's probably the number one pick. But I also feel like his stock can't get any higher than it already was at this point.
I mean, you could argue that McCaffrey's stock it's got nowhere to go but down, especially in Dynasty. You know, you get another year older with the amount of touches that he had last season. I mean, it was, you know, that was 403 touches. I mean, like that's a whole boatload of them, man. And in fact, you know, there are some people out there that would warn you that level of touches in a season is almost a guarantee of one of two things happening: regression, which I feel like is almost guaranteed, or injury. Mm-hmm. So his value is not going to get any higher than it is right now or than it was last season. And he's a touch machine. And I feel like the most important aspect of a running back's fantasy value is skill set, of course, but opportunities as well. And he's got both of those. Your son agrees.
Yes, he does.
So McCaffrey is, I mean, he's the RB1. Like, no doubt about that. But every single year that he's in the league, I mean, his stock's going to go down in dynasty leagues. That's just the way that it is right now. It's just the way that it is. If you were in a startup and you took Saquon over McCaffrey, I wouldn't argue
with you.
That was a bad move at all.
Would you, if you have Christian McCaffrey, would you consider trying to trade him and seeing what you can get back, you know, draft picks, other players? Or do you try to ride it at least one more year and seeing what you can get from it?
I mean, I'm always open to you know, taking offers, but chances are, I mean, McCaffrey's still only 23 years old, so chances are I'm not gonna be trading him for any less than, you know, Fort Knox.
All right, yeah. I mean, I mean, obviously, if you are trading him, you better be getting back a ton in return. You better get a ton back. Mm-hmm. Miles Sanders, who I feel like the fantasy community has kind of flipped on, right? Like, we all love not because of him necessarily, I should say that. We love Miles Sanders. It looked like he was going to get an opportunity to really do some big things in Philadelphia. Then early in the week, there are these rumors that the Eagles are interested in Carlos Hyde, that they may bring him in. He's on the street. He's a free agent right now. He had a 1,000-yard rushing season last year with the Houston Texans. And we're all reminded, Fabs, that Doug Peterson is not necessarily a one running back guy. So what looked like really big upside for Miles Sanders now looks like, you know, and again, they haven't done anything yet, but looks like that there might be some obstacles to him being that workhorse guy that we want him to be.
It's Carlos Hyde. It's Carlos Hyde. Like, he got a lot of touches last year because Houston had nobody else, you know, to play that role. On the early down, outside of Duke Johnson, who's, you know, more of a compliment at this point, and or at least that's what teams have been using him as for the most part. But I still like Miles Sanders. I mean, he's in my top 10 redraft rookie running backs. I still like him. Look at what he did last season. There was about that 4 or 5 game stretch where Jordan Howard was out. I mean, he averaged over 20 fantasy points a game. He was averaging right around 20 touches per game, and he was tremendous. And keep in mind, he didn't get as much publicity coming out of Penn State because Saquon was there. So he only got to start and be the featured guy for his final season with the Nittany Lions. I still really like him. I really do. I mean, I could make an argument that Miles Sanders is a better dynasty pick than Derrick Henry. Honestly, I mean,
I can make an argument.
Derrick Henry, I mean, he's what, 20, 25, and he's had a lot of freaking work in the last couple of seasons. So I think Sanders is a easy cinch top 9 or 10 dynasty running back if you're doing a startup.
Yeah. Maybe because the Carlos Hyde news kind of got me shook a little bit about Miles Sanders, but it also sort of has reminded me that Doug Peterson's never just going to give this offense over to one running back. They're going to give the reins to one guy. And I don't know if Boston Scott is going to be the guy to step in there and wreck this thing, but it always makes me sort of nervous that maybe he's not going to get the requisite touches that I would like him to get.
Right.
Devontae Adams, the Packers, in a way, did him a favor by not drafting any wide receivers, even though right. I know Aaron Rodgers is not thrilled about that. So the target share is going to be huge once again for Devontae Adams. That's the good news. The bad news is that looking forward, we've talked about this before. How much longer is Aaron Rodgers potentially going to be in Green Bay? Do they try to make a deal and move on from him and open things up for Jordan Love? Even Adams himself, he's still a fairly young guy. And wide receivers certainly have a longer shelf life than, say, running backs do. Mm-hmm. I think Adams sort of stays put value-wise, but there are sort of things to be concerned about on the horizon with him.
Yeah, there are. Listen, if I had to do a dynasty draft right now, he'd probably still end up being a first or second round pick, and I would guarantee it. So what is he, like 27 years old? Mm-hmm. But that's some of the risk that you take when you're drafting a wide receiver who's tied to a veteran quarterback who may or may not stick with the team. And to me, Adams is always going to be a target hog, even if it's Jordan Love throwing him the football, in 2021 or 2022 or both. Mm-hmm. So would he lose some value with Rodgers not being there? I mean, hell, absolutely. Like, there's no mm-hmm. question about that, but talent wise, opportunity wise, the targets are still going to be there. So I'd still have him ranked among my top 10 wide receivers without question.
Yeah. I mean, I think he's definitely still there. I know that
we've seen wide receivers put up good numbers with crappy quarterbacks in the past. I mean,
true.
Yeah.
That's absolutely. Hey, look, man, we all still love Allen Robinson and his list of quarterbacks.
Exactly.
has not been great. Right. I mean, literally Nick Foles, who will likely be his quarterback this year, might be the best quarterback he's played with in his NFL career. So right. That says something.
There you have it.
Let's go back to Dallas and Michael Gallup, who is a guy that I love. I feel like he sort of has middle child syndrome in this offense, right? Because like we talk about Amari Cooper and now we're talking about CD Lamb and like all these guys who can catch the football there. I mean, we even are talking about Blake Jarwin and what he means now that Jason Witten is gone to Las Vegas. Wait, I feel like Michael Gallup is sort of, like he really is. He's Jan Brady right now, right? Like, how are we feeling about Michael Gallup? Because he's a talented player in an offense that is right now chock full of talented players. And that may end up sort of hurting his potential here.
Well, his downfall last year, he dropped a lot of balls. I think he led the league in dropped passes at wide receiver. I could be wrong, but I know Dak as a quarterback, no quarterback had more passes dropped than Dak last season. So think about the fantasy points that were left on the ground in terms of catchable passes. But yeah, I mean, Gallup, if you're doing a startup dynasty, he's probably a three or a four, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, because CD's going ahead of him without question, and Cooper's going ahead of him without question. So Gallup's kind of the odd man out there in Dallas in terms of dynasty value, because upside wise, I mean, CD Lamb's got far more, at least in the eyes of most who do this sort of stuff for a living. So, really talented guy, 1,000-yard potential. We saw it last year. Needs to improve on the hands and not drop the ball so much. But when the Cowboys drafted Lamb, I mean, Gallup's dynasty value certainly took a hit.
Yeah, and it's kind of, I like Michael Gallup. I thought he was a guy with incredible upside. I think he still does. It's just a matter of now really fighting to get those targets, to get those opportunities. Here's a guy that I think, if you are looking to maybe make a deal, I don't know if the window has closed, but it's definitely a lot smaller in terms of what you can get back for Michael Gallup than maybe it was, a couple of months ago in that Dallas offense. Mm-hmm. I looked through some tight ends, and there were none that really jumped out to me, but there were a few that I thought were sort of intriguing. One was OJ Howard, because we immediately thought, there's all this talk that the Bucs are trying to move him. And then once Gronk came, we all thought, well, that's definitely the end of OJ Howard, but it's not. I mean, they're holding on to him. And I think part of it is that belief that they're not going to have Rob Gronkowski for more than maybe 2 years at the very most. Mm-hmm. there is potentially a future for OJ Howard there, but it just seems like it's going to be delayed. And if you are a dynasty owner, are you willing to wait on that future to come for OJ Howard in Tampa?
As long as he's not your one. If he's your two, yeah. I mean, he's still a young guy, you know, 25 years old. And the big issue, the biggest one is Gronkowski, of course. But I don't know that I would expect him to play more than a year or two in Tampa Bay. But you also have to think of if Bruce Arians is the coach there. And I think a lot of us overlooked this last season because we thought that OJ Howard had so much talent that Arians was going to use him, but he hasn't typically used his tight ends in the offenses.
He does not.
That he's been, I mean, like, you know, again, like Heath Miller is like, I feel like has been the best tight end that's come out of his system years ago in Pittsburgh. So I feel like OJ Howard as a tight end too is fine in Dynasty, but you're going to be waiting a couple of seasons and even past a couple of seasons, he's going to be a free agent. What? So he'd be a free agent in 2022 because they picked up the fifth year. So you may have to wait a little bit for a little bit of return on your investment if you get any.
Yeah. And I think that's sort of the hard part is, you know, how long do you wait on this? For the moment, Cameron Brate is also still there in Tampa. I will say this about Bruce Arians, because somebody mentioned this to me too, that Bruce Arians doesn't necessarily use his tight ends. My response was that Tom Brady does though. I mean, part of it might've been that, you know, for years he played with arguably the greatest tight end of all time, and that might have something to do with it, but he does throw the football to his tight end. So that's something worth noting. Hunter Henry. Look, man, we all want great things for Hunter Henry. He had injuries his first couple of years, really was like waiting for a big breakout season from Hunter Henry. We thought maybe last year, especially with Antonio Gates not there with the Chargers anymore, that it would happen, and it was fine. This year, he's the guy, Fabs, in that offense at the tight end position. There's no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. But there's just question marks about the quarterback now. Like, it's one thing if Philip Rivers is there slinging the rock. Now it's either Tyrod Taylor or Justin Herbert. And I'm starting to feel like maybe that Hunter Henry big breakout that we're waiting for, maybe it's just not going to happen at this point.
Maybe you're looking at a guy whose cap is, you know, 800 yards and 8 touchdowns, which is still pretty damn good. I mean, it's not
fine,
Kittle, but maybe that's his cap. And the good thing about Hunter Henry is that you sort of know what the future is going to hold for him. If he stays in Los Angeles, his quarterback's going to be Justin Herbert. And if you don't believe in Justin Herbert, then, you know, maybe you don't believe in Hunter Henry. The good news is that oftentimes a tight end can be a young quarterback's best friend, security blanket. And he's also got that with Austin Eckler as well, who's a great pass catching running back. So Henry at 25 years old, to me, is still a top 8 dynasty tight end if you're doing a startup.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I also think that some of it is, look, he's not necessarily spectacular, but he's steady enough at a position where you just want somebody who's going to kill you every week. They may not win the week for you, but you just want them to at least put up something decent.
Yeah, he's got to avoid injuries. That, you know, that's a big bugaboo with him. But I mean, if he can stay on the gridiron, dude, I mean, I feel like no matter who the quarterback is, he'll be fine.
Yeah. Speaking of guys who have to avoid injury, it just sort of leads us perfectly into Evan Engram, who we know what he can be when he's healthy. He just has struggled with that over the last couple of years, but so many things seem to work in his favor, right? I mean, he's an athletic, talented guy. They got a young quarterback. They've got a young kind of core of that offense. They're even starting to build the offensive lineup again. I mean, this Giants offense, Fabs, if everything clicks, could be interesting to watch. But you just sort of have to bake in that injury risk if you're thinking about Evan Engram in a dynasty format right now.
I mean, and all things being equal, like, you could argue that Ingram's a top 5 tight end in dynasty because of his age. He's 25. He's already shown and proven that he can be very productive. You could make an argument that he's not with Kittle, Kelsey, but I mean, maybe in the same sort of tier as like an Andrews or a Henry or a Waller, maybe an Ertz. Ertz is, Ertz is 29, but Evan has got every tool to make him successful in the league, except for the fact that he hasn't been durable. And so that's really where you have to make a decision on Evan Engram. Do you want to take a chance on the talent and hope that he stays healthy? Or do you feel like he's injury prone and not worth you know, where he'll likely be selected in the dynasty league, because I feel like he's a top eight tight end without question in such formats.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, you know, again, it's just that sort of concern. It is what your risk tolerance is,
right?
When it comes to Evan Engram. So, yep. All right. So that's a few guys, stock up, stock down. I mean, we could do this literally all day.